On this episode of Original Fare, I'm in North Carolina, or what folks call the Research Triangle. Well, specifically, I'm in Raleigh, learning how to make chocolate.
Why did you want to make chocolate?
I got a job in the chocolate industry when I was 29. And
what were you doing before that?
I worked in the skate industry.
See, here we go. Long Beach, California.
Short
I'm
story.
Trying to figure out how the you got into this.
You're trying to find the roadmap to who I am,
because,
like how I got here.
And I'm in Cary, learning from a master bread maker how to make bread.
You know, your finger are going to be your best tool. You're going to push down, and if it bounces back very fast, you need to wait. Get
this
a bit
is
more
why
volume.
I always mess up.
So.
But really what they're both teaching me is the art of dedication and patience, which guess what? I have none.
She always shows a fist.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
Join me as I attempt to hunt, forage, and farm my way across the globe in search of the best ingredients our planet has to offer. I'm Kelly Cox, and this is Original Fare. Remember last season when I went to see what cacao looked like in Costa Rica? Well, when I heard about Sam, owner and creator of Videri Chocolate in Raleigh, North Carolina, and his obsession with sourcing beans, I sought him out immediately. Then I learned he loves sorting as much as sourcing.
So this is our bean room. So I think each bag of beans has something around 10 to 12,000 beans per bag, and you're going to touch almost all of them.
Luckily, I have a lot on my mind.
So we're gonna sort some Belize that came in on 4/30 from the harvest in December. That's the reason that I make chocolate, is because I love sorting beans.
Is that true?
Yeah, I love sorting beans. I could sit and sort beans all day long. The purpose of sorting these beans is that you want to try and get like the weird stuff out. Chicken bones, twigs. Rocks.
Chicken bones happen?
Mm-hmm. Chicken bones happen, yeah. So this is a 70 kilo bag. I'm gonna walk away, go get a cup of coffee, and I'm gonna let you see how fast you can sort them. Yeah, if it doesn't work out, I can always sort it later.
You'd be so happy about that.
I'll see you in a couple hours.
Thanks for inviting me out, Sam.
Are you finished yet?
No.
Why not?
Because I'm just trying to find my rhythm here.
Yeah, so let's look at the comparison point of what you have to sort is this bucket and how much you have sorted this bucket. Let's pick up the pace, that's what I'm trying to say.
And as nice as we possible.
Sam's obsession continues when he starts roasting.
90% of our flavor comes from the roasting. But if you mess this up, you can't fix it. Okay, check that out. You didn't catch that one. Why are you here? I'm gonna fill up my roast profile sheet. And then look at the color.
So rich.
So first we're gonna do a cocoa nib, right? So I'm taking the husk off. This is what husk looks like. This is what a cocoa bean looks like. This is, right? And when I break this up, these are called nibs. Well, the National Food Safety Guidelines is 1.7% of total weight can be husk. We've sorted it out, and at the most it's 0.1% in our total weight.
So you're getting rid of?
I'm trying to get rid of all of it.
I mean, I kind of just want to eat some chocolate now, but all right, we'll keep going.
And what we're doing is we're trying to take the shell off of the bean. The heavy stuff falls, the light stuff goes up and over.
The beans have a few steps to go through, and on each one, the smells develop and change.
This smells amazing. This is Dominican, right?
Yeah.
I guess it's kind of Dominican and Ecuadorian if you really want to get technical, yeah. What it's really doing is just pushing out the cocoa butter
in those
cocoa nibs, right? So like this is what it looks like. It's very, very strong and sharp and has a lot of those like unripe cherry raspberry, weird, and then it hopefully it finishes with cocoa. But the way that, the reason you're grinding this is you're letting out more of those volatile characteristics of the bean. So let's say you let this grind for 5 days.
Yeah.
It would be a very muted chocolate. And you would taste chocolate, but you wouldn't taste those little intricate or more delicate flavors. If you grind it for 5 days and you keep it covered, you might keep more of those in there and you'll have a very smooth textured chocolate. In chocolate making, you're always battling texture and flavors. And if you want to leave a lot of texture in, you're going to get a lot more flavor. But on somebody's palate, they might not be able to like get all those flavors because the texture is too big.
At each step, I think I'm getting a little closer to eating. Girl skips breakfast before a shoot. But the complexity in chocolate making thickens.
And then when this is done,
you pour them out into these bins, right? Bin, bin, refrigerator, they cool. And then they turn into these things, right?
And this is just bean.
This is just Dominican, Oco Caribe.
Right.
Right.
And then what happens?
And then we go in here and we chop them. You want to show Kelly how to chop?
Sure, yeah.
Do you don't mind?
Yeah, that's no problem.
And I told her that it's about muscles. It's all about muscles. But really, it's about technique.
Force and technique.
Force and technique.
You get your blade, catch it like that, pretty much kind of force and rock it down. It's really not cutting it. It's really kind of more about just like rocking and forcing it through because it's not going to slice through like it's cheese or anything like that, sadly.
Okay. And I'm kind of starting small. So loud. Why am I so loud? Yours is so soft. How am I doing, Nate?
You're doing good, yeah.
So this is going to be batch 1069. It's going to be dark milk. And it's going to come off on the 21st of May.
But then you temper?
The waiting. Because then you put it into a grinder, a conch. Conch grinder.
In the conch.
Yeah. You want me to turn one on for you? Let's go look at it. So this is a conch. It's a rotary conch. There's a series of metal fins in there that are rubbing up the side of against the side of a drum. Dump that blend of chocolate we chopped up in a certain amount of time, and we add sugar at a certain rate in time and cocoa butter at a certain rate in time, and we add a certain amount of pressure and heat to this machine to make that chocolate. So this has already been in a tempering machine. Anything that's a batch has just been in that big machine. My guess is that from the time we open a bag of beans to by the time it becomes a block of chocolate to a tempered bar of chocolate is somewhere in between 2 to 4 months. Mm-hmm. And that's the way our cycle works and the way that we build in aging into our chocolate.
But Sam's processes weren't put into place overnight.
What was the first piece of chocolate you made?
Oh. Carrie, where's that block of dark milk chocolate?
He saved it?
Is it in the chocolate library?
When I opened this factory, I thought it was hot. I'm like, I know what's going on. I'm gonna make milk chocolate. I'm gonna make dark milk chocolate. It's gonna be the best. It was garbage. I saved it and I still have it as a reminder of like, you're not hot. And you have to work really hard at trying to make something good all the time. And so everybody that comes to work in this factory, there it is. Gets that same lecture about like how much hot shit I thought I was. So you have all these fun things,
right?
You have banana jasmine, lavender. The banana jasmine is this little magic right here. You have a strawberry anise ganache, which is delicious. You have a French martini, which I love, which is this one over here. We know all things.
No, I want to try this banana jasmine ganache
on
camera.
Yeah.
Because
it's bananas.
It's jasmine. Nobody uses jasmine enough. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's good, right?
It makes me angry. It's so good.
Right?
It makes me want to throw something.
Carrie, you have to relay these messages to Nicole.
Oh my God.
Again, angered another customer.
Persistent patience. It's a quality I recognize, but one I'm pretty sure I don't possess. So who best to put it to the test than a master bread maker?
They're shaping everything now, and then they stick them here, and then does it all go into the oven next?
No, mix, shape, between all that is fermentation.
How important is the fermentation process in your bread making?
Fermentation are the essence of baking. Different, you know, in the acidity, you have lactic, acetic, you have so many different, you know, aroma coming through. You know, as much as, you know, when you test a wine, you know, you can test all this, you know, in all your bread.
Lionel began bread making at the esteemed Les Compagnons du Devoir in France at the wee age of 16. I was a little surprised to find a French master bread maker in the little metro enclave of Cary, North Carolina.
What did I think I was getting into? He's French. Of course, there's a lot of very detailed technique happening that always overwhelms me.
But that's why you guys make the best food and the best wine.
So we are going to make a multi-grain bread. This is what is our white flour over there. Here we have whole wheat. So I put 0.33 each, so it's going to be 0.66 over there, all right. Now I'm going to add ambrosia rye. So I'm going to total it of 1 pound. When you want to weigh the salt or anything else, you don't, you know, have put this on the top of your flour. Because if you put too much, it's very difficult if it's inside your flour.
Right.
I'm going to add, you know, so 0.02. So what we are going to do over there, we are going to add, you know, 0.2, okay, of, you know, grain. You know, 0.75, okay, of water. And I'm going to put 0.3. See, look at that. It's not beautiful. If this is ready, it needs to float. If it's not float, you know, you need more maturity of it. I say you always start with one hand to help you to turn the bowl, and here, you know, you're going to bring everything all together. Okay, so when, you know, you don't see any more flour, well, we are going to put everything on the table like that. All right?
Okay.
And what I want you to do, it's also to scrape down your bowl. And why you want to scrape down your bowl? Because on the edge, you might have some salt who are, you know, to clean this up. And put some pressure on the plastic, all right? And here you're going to grab, I see you have a clean bowl. It's going to be only index of each end are going to work. So it's going to go all around your thumbs, like that, okay? So you look like a little chicken ass, look at that. And I don't want to see any pinching. I want to see this finger go and go all the way. Okay? See here? I want to cut. I don't want to pull and tear.
Oh wow, okay.
But you know.
But are you really cutting it all the way?
You cut all the way, yeah. So you do this 5 to 7 times over here. And here you fold. You quarter turn. Quarter turn. We start again, okay? And here you cut all the way. So, more energy, you know, more, you know, speed you're going to put, less sticky it's going to become. Look at that, all this energy she put into it. It's great.
So what we're doing here?
Is to develop the gluten.
Developing the gluten.
Yeah, and you know, by hand you cannot overmix. So people are a little bit, so you do this, so people ask me, how long do I do this? I say, until it doesn't stick. You relax a little bit, the dough to relax a little bit, so it develop on his own, all right?
I'm the sprinter. I want everything to be perfect right now.
No. Let me rephrase. Patience. After that, we are going to fold the dough. So 1, 2, 3, okay, and 4. And here, you see, we have what we're looking for.
That's pretty beautiful.
Okay, so you want to try? Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm picking it.
Grab the dough, put your hand, you know, parallel, and you're going to do this. And you're going to do that. This is how it works.
Get up again this
way. Yeah, this way. Turn
it. Bring it parallel.
Now do this.
Now do.
Yeah, go ahead. Bring this. And, you know, we have a dough who can be, you know, war form. Yes?
Okay.
So what I'm going to do, I'm going to incorporate the grain. So rule of thumbs, anything bigger then the flour, you develop your gluten first, and you can add at the end of your mix. So now is my grain over there. I'm going to fold this in.
Oh wow.
Okay, and you know, just to bring this, it's just a couple of turns. Here I'm finished. And you see, we don't use any flour. There's no need for this.
I know.
No, okay. Here I'm going to fold it, just gently. So to come together?
Wow, look at that. That's and cool. The only thing I think I can do is squeeze the grains back in. Because I forgot the first part.
Add your grain.
And then we do the fun squeezing action yep. that I have mastered.
Wow. You have mastered. There we go. Lovely. And now you can fold it. We need to take the final dough temperature.
Really?
Okay. We're looking for to be between 75 to 80. You know, we're at 78.9, so it's fantastic. So this are going to now, we are going to cover it up, okay? A bread needs to be covered, you know, so we put back in a bowl with plastic wrap, you know, so it's no any draft. See, I'm going to add a little bit of flour so it doesn't stick. Okay. So here is flour.
Now, what's with the hand move like that instead of just doing this?
Okay, because here, you know, I say you feed the chicken. Flour can be your friend, but it can become your enemy. So you never go from so high. Where you're on the flour is where your hand are going to be. And also is your hand, how it quickly opened up. See, yeah. It's a cloud. You barely seen it, but it's there. I pull, and here I'm going to make something rectangular. I'm going to try to be as close as I can, then 1 pound. I have a little bit too much, I take out. All right? Here we find, put this over there. Gently.
Just a little.
Just a little to balance everything, so it's even everywhere, okay? All right? Always you need to be comfortable, you know, on your feet. She's pushing me already. All right. We always double check it doesn't stick, okay?
Yeah.
It doesn't stick on your table. So now we are going to take in front of you. Here I'm going to fold, okay? I'm going to use the palm of my hand. Pushing down. Now we are going to overlap over here and push down again. Yeah, and we are going to lift up everything to see it doesn't stick. Doesn't stick, we put this back down. I'm going to roll this over. I'm going to lift this up and I'm going to push down on the seam. You see when I'm going to push down over there? See the dough over there? See, I create some tension. You look at your dough, go good, and find the right angle. All right, up, that's it. Now I'm going to take out my finger. Roll this again, lift this up, and push again. On the seam, very nice. A little bit more, to, you see, give, yeah, you give the strength. And now, I'm going to seal. Roll this, see the seam is up, over there, put this in the grain.
Flip it.
Yeah, flip it. This hand over there, yeah. Go ahead, push, push, push. Now we click in, yeah, now you push back, yeah, you pull back, yeah. Very nice.
That's so cool.
Now I'm closing it and I'm going to add the steam. So what steam does is slowing down baking process, caramelization exactly, okay. It's going to also give a shiny color, it's going to help to expand, you know, the dough. And to form the crust.
It amazes me the places you can uncover craft and artistry. When I was planning my story in Raleigh, I had of course expected to eat well, but I didn't anticipate being faced with what I now realize is integral to success in any field.
Very nice, beautiful.
Dedication and patience. I'm really gonna have to work on that. And now for some gratuitous bread making techniques.
Okay. And you know, you as you go, everything moves. So it's even. So we don't want people to have so much thickness. So when the first bite is flour in their mouth. Okay? Harder you tap, more flour fall.
Look, that's too much. No?
We forgive you.
I'm not fired.
Not quiet.
The day is young though.
Exactly.
I can do a lot of damage in a short
amount
of time.
You know, and it's free labor, so.
It's true.
For more adventures in food, subscribe to our channel.